makes this fun.
Indeed.
He's going to turn on the streamer. Look.
Okay. We're going. We're in A.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Michelle.
Thank you.
receipt.
Carolyn's receipt.
By the way, in case anyone's wondering, we're the Maple Trio. We are the Maple Trio. And next, we're going to do a couple of songs by Turlough O'Carolan. Sorry.
Thank you. Good morning. Let's see if this is on. There we go. Good morning. I'm Brett Amy Thielen, your moderator for today. I'm pleased to welcome you to the Monadnock Summer Lyceum with today's guest speaker, Tom Wessels. Before we get started, I'd like to thank today's musicians, Maple Tree O, for providing, yes. For providing the music many of you enjoyed while waiting for the live broadcast to begin. Also, thank you to the Gilbert Verney Foundation for generously sponsoring today's event, and to Victory Garden star Roger Swain for the beautiful flowers. For many years, the Monadnock Summer Lyceum has brought outstanding world-class speakers to the Monadnock region to serve as catalysts to inform, engage, and inspire an active citizenry on local, national, and global issues. Today's talk is being recorded and will soon be available as a podcast and as a video on our website, monadnocklyceum.org. Programs are rebroadcast on WSMN 1590 AM the following Sunday at 10 AM and on WUML 91.5 FM the following Wednesday at 11 AM and the following Sunday at 3 PM. As is the tradition of the Lyceum, after the presentation, our speaker will answer questions from the audience. Those present in the meeting house may write your questions on the yellow card in the pew in front of you, and an usher will come around to collect them. For those watching virtually, please submit your questions by using the live comments section on Facebook or YouTube. The Monadnock Summer Lyceum is supported entirely through contributions from our audience members. We deeply appreciate your donations, which may be placed in the glass bowls in the church and in the parish hall. Those listening at home may make contributions on our website or by mailing your donation. Thank you for your generous support. In your pew, you will find a green card. We hope you will give us feedback on today's program and join our mailing list and or email list. You can either mail the green card to us or drop it in the bowls alone or with your contribution to the sustainability of the Monadnock Lyceum. For those watching virtually, you may provide feedback on today's program, suggestions for next summer speakers, make a donation, or join our mailing list through our website. Following the program, we invite you to attend an informal reception in the parish hall through the door to my right. Our speaker today is Tom Wessels. I first met Tom nearly 20 years ago during my very first semester as a graduate student in the Environmental Studies Department at Antioch University, New England, when I took a class with him called Community Ecology. Every week, our class would meet in a different forest, and Tom would teach us to read clues in the landscape, how the presence of many small stones in a stone wall speaks of an agricultural history, or how multiple trunk trees tell of past logging or forest fire. Every week, he would blow our minds with the level of detail he was able to discern. Sometimes even the exact year, even if it was two centuries ago, that a tree blew down in a storm. That time with Tom forever changed the way I look at the land. For those of us who study the natural world, Tom's deep knowledge of the New England woods is the stuff of legend. What many people don't know is that he is also a keen observer of desert and alpine ecosystems. It didn't take long for me to learn that if Tom invites you to go for a hike with him, you go. And so I followed him not only through the woods of Vermont and New Hampshire, but up granite balds in coastal Maine and through old lava fields and desert washes in northern Mexico. Through it all, whatever the landscape, Tom's focus has always been on ecological connection, with an emphasis on cooperation over competition. And because he thinks in the lifespan of trees instead of the lifespan of humans, because he sees the world in geological time instead of the lifetime of any one species, he has a uniquely steadfast and dare I say, hopeful perspective on the future of the natural world, something many of us could use more of in our lives. It is truly an honor to introduce my friend, mentor, and fellow desert rat, renowned ecologist, Tom Wessels.
I think that's it? Okay, very good. Well, thank you very much. Today's talk is going to be very much based in science. It may sound heady, the things I'm going to talk about, but I think you're going to find it's actually quite commonsensical. So I'm going to talk about three scientific principles, the first being the second law of thermodynamics and its relationship to entropy. And then I'm going to talk about the principle of self-organization, and then the process of coevolution, which you'll see is a self-organizing process. So let me start with the second law of thermodynamics. Now, there's two major laws of thermodynamics. The first is the law of conservation of energy that states that energy can neither be created nor destroyed. And that's a pretty compelling idea because it means all the energy in the universe today is exactly what it was, down to the microjoule, that it was 13.8 billion years ago. So that's very, very profound. But from a sustainability perspective, which this talk is going to focus on, it's the second law that is much more important to focus on, because that is the law of transformation of energy. And although it states that we cannot create nor destroy energy, energy can be transformed from one state to another. So right now outside, a lot of the vegetation around here is capturing sunlight and converting it into chemical bond energy, where hydrogen atoms are bonded onto carbon atoms in the growing biomass of these plants. So there we've transformed light to chemical bond energy. And then any of you that heat with wood, when you are burning, you know, your stove in the wintertime, that chemical bond energy is being transformed into heat energy. And through those transformations, no energy is being created or destroyed, but we're transforming it from one state to another. But the critical aspect about the second law is that whenever there's a transformation within the system where that transformation occurs, there's always a loss of energy during the transformation. So that means that open systems like our bodies that can take in energy and give off energy, they can be in one of three energetic states. So if a system is taking in more energy than it's bleeding off from its transformations, it's called a neg or anti-entropic system, and that's a system that grows because it's storing that energy in the growth as it's taking in more of it. So all of us were anti-entropic systems in our youth. We took in more energy in the form of kilocalories from our food than we were bleeding off from all the metabolic transformations that were happening in our bodies. But when a system reaches maturity, it becomes a dynamic equilibrium system. And that means the amount of energy it's taking in is equal to the amount being released by its transformation. So as we reach adulthood, that's what we become. We become these dynamic equilibrium systems. But it's the third state, where a system takes in less energy than it's bleeding off, that I want to focus on, because that's called an entropic system. And it's often said that as a system bleeds off energy and becomes entropic, it moves from a state of order to disorder. And actually, those are very subjective ways of looking at entropy. I remember back in the 1980s, I taught at the Putney School, an independent secondary school, and I was a dorm head of a girls' dormitory. And every Sunday, I do room inspections to try to help the girls in my dorm keep their room sort of orderly. And I can assure you, their sense of order and my sense of order were really, really different. So, order, disorder, very objective, subjective ways of looking at entropy, but a much more objective way is that entropic systems, as they bleed off energy, always move from a state of complexity to a state of simplicity, and a state of concentration of energy and materials to a state of diffusion of energy and materials. So imagine a tree falling down a forest around here. It uproots, and it dies. It's now going to become an entropic system. And as decomposers move into that dead tree and start breaking down its really complex molecules of cellulose and lignin into very simple molecules of carbon dioxide and water that then diffuse out in the atmosphere, that tree's structure is being simplified. And its energy and materials are being diffused out. And after many, many decades, that tree will cease to exist. All of its complex structure will be broken down to simple molecules of carbon dioxide, water, nitrogen gas that diffuse into the air, and simple inorganic molecules that diffuse into the soil. Now, the reason I'm mentioning this, life has been on this planet for 3.8 billion years. That is a really long time. So to try to get a sense of how long that is, I want you to visualize a sheet of paper and imagine the thickness of the sheet equaling a century. So my question is, how tall a stack would we need, each sheet representing a century, to equal 3.8 billion years? And the answer is, we'd need a stack of paper over 3 miles in height. That is a lot of centuries. But during the first 3.5 billion years of the biosphere's existence on this planet, it was an anti-entropic system. It was taking in more energy from solar gain than was bleeding off as heat to outer space through all of its biological transformations. And as a result, all the biomass in this planet grew up. A lot of it stored as coal and petroleum deposits underground. And then about 300 million years ago, the Earth became a dynamic equilibrium system. And we know that because oxygen levels have been pretty basically consistent around 21% for the last 300 million years. But for the first time in this planet's history, the biosphere is now an entropic system, and the entropy is caused by the energy transformations of just one species, and that's us humans. Pretty much any environmental problem you can think of today is a problem of entropy. So removing of primary tropical rainforest to make way for soybean and sugarcane plantations is entropic. We're taking really complex ecosystems and replacing them by simplified monocultures. Erosion of soil from industrial agriculture is an entropic process where we're taking really complex systems in soil, simplifying them, and then having the nutrients in those soils diffuse out. And even the burning of carbon-based fossil fuels is an entropic process. We're taking concentrated stores of carbon and diffusing it in the atmosphere. And the problem is that each year, the biosphere is getting more and more and more entropic because the amount of energy transformations we're creating keeps increasing. And we cannot continue down this road too much longer. Systems are nested inside each other. So we have cells in our bodies nested in organs, organs nested in our bodies. We here are nested in a community of people. And all of, you know, humanity and its socioeconomic systems are nested in the biosphere. And if any one smaller system starts extracting energy at rates higher than the larger system can replenish, the larger system becomes entropic, and eventually feedback loops are going to kick into place, which are going to curtail the growth of the smaller system. It's not a question if that will happen. It becomes a question of when that will happen. So this second law is the underlying basis for why our trajectory is not sustainable. It will not sustain us. And if we don't change our ways, the path we're on will eventually fail us. So I'd like to move to the principle of self-organization, because that's going to give us a model for how we can think about restructuring human systems to become way more sustainable. Now, for about 4 centuries, Western science has been very much sort of enmeshed in a linear reductionistic paradigm. This paradigm was very much established by René Descartes back in the 1600s. Descartes was enamored by the machines of his age, things like windmills and water mills and wind-up clocks and fountains that all had parts that moved. And he started seeing these machines as not being any dissimilar from organisms like ourselves. And he thought, if we want to understand something, all we need to do is take it apart. That's the reductionism. Take it apart, identify all the parts, and then figure out the sequence in which the parts interacted. And since he was looking at machines, those parts were interacting in a very linear way, part A with part B with part C, and so on. And linear reductionism has been very powerful, but when it comes to looking at complex systems, these are systems that have feedback loops, it has some major failings. So in the late 19th century, a lot of people doing research in disciplines like anthropology, sociology, biology, meteorology, psychology, were finding that linear reductionism was not helping them understand their subject areas. So right after World War II finished, a series of conferences were convened in New York City that brought researchers from all sorts of different disciplines, some studying human systems, some studying natural systems, just to start talking to each other. And what became apparent was that whether people were looking at human systems, like a sociologist, or natural systems, like an ecologist, they were all seeing the exact same principles and phenomena at play. They were seeing feedback loops. They were seeing emergent properties, things you could not predict by simply looking at the sum of the parts. They were seeing bifurcation events where the system could quickly flip its behavior into a new mode of operation. And what rose out of that was a new sort of paradigm of science called complex system science. And complex system science is really a wonderful thing because when you understand the principles that work in complex systems, you can be very transdisciplinary. In the book, The Myth of Progress, I really critique the economic system, even though I have no background as an economist, because I'm looking at it strictly as how a complex system functions, and it's not functioning well in terms of how complex systems that sustain themselves function. So out of one of the principles that came out of this body of knowledge called complex system science was the principle of self-organization. And what self-organization is as a system grows in that anti-entropic phase, the system not only gets bigger, but it gets more complex. And the complexity is derived from the parts within the system becoming ever more specialized through time and ever more tightly integrated together, so that each part doing what it needs to do for its own purposes is creating conditions that supports the whole and creates a system that's moving to become more and more energy efficient, more and more stable, and more resilient. So I'll go through that one more time, because that's quite a bit of verbiage there, but I want you to get this because it's basically what the whole talk's about. So self-organization, as a system grows, it not only gets bigger, it gets more complex. The complexity is derived with the parts becoming ever more specialized and tightly integrated together, such that each part doing what it needs to do for its own purposes creates the condition that supports the whole, and as a result, these self-organizing systems grow more energy efficient, more stable, and more resilient. So luckily for us, we didn't have to think about this, but during our developmental years, we were self-organizing. As miraculous as it is, we all started life as a single microscopic cell. And that one cell did not just multiply to 30 trillion cells, which our bodies house pretty much today. Luckily for us, those cells started specializing. And now we've got 254 different cell types in our bodies. But the specialization goes even further. Some nerve cells just communicate with a sensory cell. Other nerve cells just communicate with a muscle cell. Other neurons connect sensory neurons to motor neurons. Our cells are incredibly specialized. But luckily for us, they're tightly integrated together, each cell doing what it needs for its own purposes, creating conditions that support the whole. And as a result, our bodies are very stable. You go into our internal bodily environment, temperature right at 98.6, blood pH right at 6.8, blood sugar levels very carefully controlled. We're really stable, and we're also resilient. We get sick, or we get injured, we heal, because we're highly self-organized entities. So are people getting this process? Is this making sense? Okay. So I want to shift to coevolution, because that's the model I'm going to use to start looking at human systems. Coevolution is a self-organizing process that happens in ecosystems through evolutionary time. Now, out in these natural ecosystems, the bottom line currency is an energy currency. But unlike our currencies in our economy, which are, you know, dollars or euros, energy in the natural world is a solid currency. A kilocalorie of energy is always a kilocalorie of energy. But the critical thing out there is that energy is finite. There's only so much of it. So nature is always urging organisms to develop behaviors or strategies or adaptations to make themselves more energy efficient. Because if an organism can become more energy efficient, it can support a larger population on the same finite amount of energy. And this drive by nature to urge organisms to become more energy efficient is a major driver of coevolution. Now, for a long time, ecologists have been telling us that we shouldn't be moving organisms from one part of the world into another part of the world, because when we do that, we create young ecological interactions where the species involved have had no chance to co-evolve together. And those relationships are usually negative for one or more parties. So I'm just going to give you one example. In 1904, Asiatic chestnut trees were being planted in the Bronx down in New York City. At that time, in 1904, the American chestnut was one of the most common forest trees in the temperate deciduous forest of eastern North America. Down in the heart of its range, places like Tennessee and Kentucky, one out of every four trees was American chestnut, and these trees were immense. It's hard to imagine this with broadleaf trees, but we have pre-blight photographs of American chestnuts up to 14 feet in diameter. So that is about the width of these double pews right here. So we could really have maybe four American chestnut trees stuffed into this church, and it would pretty much fill the whole space. They produce the most edible nut of any tree in North America. They're truly the signature tree of the temperate deciduous forest, but took only about 30 years for this exotic chestnut blight that was brought in 1904 in those Asiatic chestnuts to spread throughout the range of American chestnut and almost completely exterminate it. That's an example of a negative outcome of a young ecological interaction where the species have not co-evolved. Now, I'd like you to take the position of the fungus. If you're a host-specific parasite, the worst thing you could do is eradicate your host species. Because if you really do that, you've just eradicated your whole population. If you think about it, that was a really energy wasteful for that fungus to do, to kill its host trees. It would have been much better served if it didn't kill its host trees. It would have lived longer. It would have reproduced more. There'd be more of a resource for its offspring. It did just about the very, very worst thing it could do. So in this instance, both these species were dramatically harmed by this young ecological relationship. Now, if two species make it through that first contact without extinguishing each other, natural selection kicks into gear, starts pushing them to become more energy efficient, and that can drive what can turn out to be predatory interactions, like what was happening between that fungus and American chestnut. It can push them all the way up to become mutualisms, where both species not only benefit by interacting, but have to interact to survive in what's called an ecological mutualism. So my favorite example of this involves the bull's horn acacia tree. This is a tree that grows down in Central America in its resident Azteca acacia ant. The ant in this tree have co-evolved over probably millions of years and today are in an obligate mutualism. And during that time, the acacias developed three features to serve as its ants. First of all, the thorns that used to ward off herbivores have become huge and swollen and pliable. They no longer protect the tree, but the ants drill into them, hollow them out, and that's where they raise their young. Secondly, on every leaf stem, there's an open sapwell or nectary where the ants go to drink. That's where they get their water and their carbohydrate energy resource. And then thirdly, on the leaf tip of every leaflet is a little globule called a Belchian body. The ants go there, they harvest those, and that's where they get their nutrition. And then those Belchian bodies grow back again. The ants have become so specialized that they can only survive on acacia sap and Belchian bodies. If you take them off their tree and offer them honey, sugar water, it doesn't matter, they will die. They can only live on those things that the acacia provides because they become so specialized to their host tree. But in return, they give their host tree the most advanced plant defense system of any plant in the world. The ants have a super venomous sting that wards off all herbivores, so these trees never get munched at all. But not only that, if vines try to crawl up the trunk of an acacia, the ants will come down and chop through them and kill them. If a surrounding tree tries to grow in the acacia space, the ants will go over in that tree and defoliate it. So if you remove acacia ants from its tree, it'll be dead in about a month's time. Now, what's amazing about this obligate mutualism is it's known from the mandibular structure of the ants that they were derived from leafcutter ants. So way back when in time, when that first ancestral ant and the first ancestral acacia came into contact, it was probably not a pretty sight. Trees were being defoliated, possibly killed. That was an energy wasteful thing to do, and somehow natural selection kicked into gear and caused these species to co-evolve up to this current mutualism where they both benefit by interacting in this way. Now, another example of, and by the way, you'll see it, these two plants, I mean, these two species are super specialized. Both of them cannot exist without their partner because they've become so specialized. Now, another way we can see coevolution working is in interspecific competition, competition between individuals of different species. If there's a lot of competitive overlap, that's a very energy wasteful thing to do. The parties involved are losing a lot of energy through their competitive struggles. So if that's the case, natural selection kicks into gear and forces them to specialize to avoid that competition. So this can happen through what's called temporal separation, where the species specialized become active at different times of day or night or different times of the season. So that can happen with owls foraging at night while hawks are foraging in the day. In this way, they do not compete because they're going after different prey at different times. And that temporal separation can even happen in the plant world. So one of my favorite things to do when we get into late April is go out into our calcium-enriched woodlands in the region, and long before the leaves of the sugar maple and white ash and bitternut hickory have leafed out, the understory in those forests will be carpeted in brilliant emerald green from the leaves of wild leeks and Dutchman's breeches and trout lilies and squirrel corn. I should mention all four of those species are called vernal ephemerals. They grow up in April, they do all their photosynthesis in April into early May, and then when the canopy leaves leaf out, they die back below ground, and a whole second cohort of plants grows up, like maidenhair fern and baneberry and blue cohosh and things like that. And in this way, we have these two groups of plants that are temporally separating when they're active so they don't compete for light, and so they can coexist. Now, the last example I want to give before we get into human systems, because I've only got about another 12 minutes, it looks like, and I wanted to get into human systems, is I want you to imagine a wildflower field out here during the bloom season, all the way from late April into November. And my question is, if we were to monitor that field, that whole period of time, how many different insect pollinating species do you think we'd find? And I can tell you it's going to be way over 1,000 different insect pollinators. All these different species of bees and hornets and wasps and moths and butterflies and flies and beetles and ants, all photosynthesizing at different times of night or day, different times of that bloom season, in different ways. And what this develops is an incredible amount of repetition of function. And that might not sound good, but that's one of the secrets of the stability and the resiliency in our ecosystems. Every critical role out there has thousands of species handling that role. If you think about decomposition, in our woodlands around here, we've probably got well over 20,000 different species of decomposers in the form of, you know, fungi and bacteria and invertebrates and all sorts of things. And the same thing with photosynthesis. In the region, we have thousands of different photosynthetic plants. And that means if any one pollinator or decomposer or plant goes extinct, the system's fine because we have all these other species doing that same critical role. So self-organization is a process that not only builds up this incredible diversity through specialization that's tightly integrated together, but when it does that, it decentralizes critical functional roles to get more and more and more players doing that role, which is building up the stability and the resiliency of the system. So is this making sense to people? All right, so I want to turn to human systems. So it's my guess that Western scientists may have been the last people to come upon this idea of self-organization. I think indigenous people intuited this way long ago, thousands and thousands of years ago. And actually, it was even written about in a book 200 years before Western science came upon self-organization. It was written about in a book that was published in 1776 titled The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith. And if you know Adam Smith, he's considered the father of sort of modern economic theory. Now, Smith was looking at pre-industrial economic systems. He was focusing on merchant economies, basically. So he would look at, you know, a village or, you know, a town, and he'd see, well, there's a butcher, there's a baker, there's a blacksmith, there's a brewer. And what intrigued him, without anyone orchestrating it, all these different merchants were creating relationships that were mutually beneficial. So the butcher would buy knives that the blacksmith made, and in return, the blacksmith would buy meat from the butcher, and back and forth. And so what Smith wrote about quite eloquently was what he called the invisible hand of the economy. No one was directing these interrelationships. They were developing on their own. But what he's also writing about is a truly self-organized, highly self-organized economic system. So these merchants are incredibly specialized. The blacksmith only dealing with metal, the butcher only with meat, the brewer only with beer, the baker only with bread. And yet, they were tightly integrated together, supporting each other and creating this resilient network through that process. Now, if you look at our economic system today, you'll see we've shifted way far away from that. It doesn't matter what sector you want to look at. It could be agriculture, it could be media, retail, pharmaceuticals, energy, financial. It doesn't really matter. You'll see that the bulk of the capital is going through a very few hands of very large corporate entities. And these large corporate entities are not really interested in creating integrated relations with other entities in their sector. They would just as soon dominate their sectors through competitive exclusion, mergers, or acquisitions. So we've moved way far away from a self-organized model. When you do that, you create systems that lack stability and lack resiliency. So one example of this was the 2008 financial meltdown. At that time, basically risky investments were basically earmarked as the reason for that meltdown. Well, risky investments were the catalyst, but the underlying reason for the meltdown was that the financial system was terribly concentrated and lacked self-organization. In 2008, 54% of all the banking assets in this country were held by just 10 banks. That's an incredible concentration of wealth in very few hands. And all the banks were all involved in the same forms of investments. They weren't specialized, and they weren't integrated. So once Lehman Brothers bellied up, if the federal government hadn't rushed in to shore up the system, that whole thing would have cascaded down. Because so many banks failed at that time and that got gobbled up by the larger banks, the financial system is even less self-organized today than it was in 2008. The last time I checked, 82% of all the banking assets in this country are now held by the top 10 banks. I don't know what the next catalyst will be, but if there is one, we're going to see a financial crisis that's going to be much greater than what happened in 2008, because this system lacks the resiliency of a self-organized system. Now, the question is, how did we get here? How did we move from something that was initially quite self-organized to one that's not? And I would believe it was the advent of flexible and economically inexpensive energy resources in the form of petroleum and electricity. Because what that allowed was the development of mechanization. Now, in an economic context, economic efficiency is measured by how much product or service output can be produced per unit of human labor. Because human labor is the most costly thing in our economy, so if you can reduce human labor by mechanizing, a business can become more profitable and more economically efficient. But the problem is, once a business mechanizes, they've now become energy inefficient, terribly energy inefficient. And that inefficiency is not just represented by the energy that those machines are using, but by all the hidden embedded energy in the making of those machines. So I would imagine, think about some sort of robotic machines that are building cars. How much energy went into extracting all the raw materials out of the earth to make those machines? How much energy then went into refining those materials? How much energy then taking those refined materials and processing them into parts, and then shipping them to places where they're built into the machines, which are then shipped around to be used? Embedded energy is the big hidden problem for all of us. We can monitor our own energy usages in our homes, in our car. We can see how much gasoline we're buying, how much electricity we're using, how much, you know, oil we're burning or cordwood. But we're not seeing at all how much embedded energy we are, you know, picking up in the commodities we buy, because so much of it is hidden from view. And that's the biggest driver of energy use in this country, is all that embedded energy. So by mechanizing, we are now becoming, as a society, incredibly energy efficient. So I will just give you one example of this. Down in Greenfield, Mass. Is a brew pub called the People's Pint. One of my former grad students, Alden Booth, started that. He came to Antioch as a graduate student who was really interested in composting, growing organic vegetables. He also liked making beer. But he came to us because he wanted to get into basically sustainable resource management in terms of looking at waste streams and how we can minimize them through his composting and other things. And while he's going to school, he and a friend who also liked making beer started realizing, where they lived in Greenfield, there was really no place to hang out that was a really social place where people could just, in the community, come together and be there. And so they decided to start the People's Pint. And it's been very successful. And the last time I was there, their menu is mostly locally sourced foods, a lot of vegetarian meals, you know, chicken, some fish meals. But the last time I was there was only one beef meal. And that was a hamburger or cheeseburger. Now, that beef comes from organically raised, grass-grown steers from a farm of a friend of Alden's that's about 10 miles from the People's Pint. So that's why you think about the amount of embedded energy that's going into that meat that comes to make the hamburgers for the People's Pint. Now, right away, that farm has a tractor. They're using diesel fuel. There's embedded energy in the manufacture of that tractor, but they use that tractor to cut hay, spread manure for their steers. They also have fencing, so there's embedded energy in the fencing. They have a barn, there's embedded energy there, there's electrical use in the barn, embedded energy there, and then there's gonna be embedded energy in the slaughtering of the animals, the grinding of the meat, and the transporting it 10 miles to the People's Pint. I don't know what the embedded energy is in a People's Pint hamburger, but there's a certain amount. But I'd like to contrast that with McDonald's. Now, McDonald's, as a worldwide producer of hamburgers, sources its steers from around the world. And the bulk of those steers are grain-fed. And once you grain-feed a steer, a totally grain-fed steer has about 10 times the amount of embedded energy of a totally grass-fed steer. That means, right away, 10 times the amount of environmental degradation through entropy. But not only that, those steers can be shipped thousands of miles to slaughterhouses, where after they're butchered, machines take over to grind up the beef, machines make the patties, machines wrap the patties, machines box them, put them into freezers. Then those patties can be shipped thousands of miles to distribution centers, and then shipped from there hundreds of miles to the retail outlets. And all that shipping involves using refrigerated, you know, trucks, which are using huge amounts of energy. I don't know what the amount of embedded energy in a McDonald's hamburger is compared to People's Pint, but I wouldn't doubt it's 20 times or more higher. And that means 20 times or more the environmental impact. So what self-organization is, it's a scientific rationale for why we need to re-regionalize and relocalize our economies to get rid of all that embedded energy that we don't see. Because once you're small, you don't need mechanization. A lot of our farms around here have very little mechanization and can produce a lot of stuff. So I'm just going to give two more examples, and then we'll go to questions. If you ever get the chance, down in Orange, Massachusetts, visit Seeds of Solidarity Farm. They only have an open house a few times a year. It's run by Deb Habib, who's another former grad student of mine, and Ricky Barak. When they got this farm in around 25 years ago, they decided they'd never touch the soil. They said, you know, we don't ever see anywhere in the natural world where the soil's turned over every year. Why would you want to do that? If soil develops, it gets more and more complex because it's a self-organizing system. It holds nutrients much better. It holds more water. Why disturb it every year? So they've been practicing no-till now for 25 years. UMass soil scientists are now studying their soils, considering them the most fertile agricultural soils in the state. They're also finding that he is getting the highest yield of produce of any farm in the state. And Ricky does this without any farm equipment at all. The only energy going into his farm is his human labor, because all he's doing, because he's doing no-till, is he's planting and he's harvesting. He has no weed problems. So he's using no herbicides, he's using no fertilizers, he's using no petroleum at any source, because he doesn't have a tractor or anything. The only sort of technological equipment he's using, he has hoop houses to where he grows his more fragile things like greens and stuff. And he has a solar panel run drip irrigation system. What he is showing is with very little energy expenditure, his farm is producing a huge amount of produce. Now, we often hear that to feed the world, we have to have these huge industrial farms. What Ricky is showing, no, we don't have to. We can produce as much or more food per acre, but we have to do it in a way that honors how nature works by maintaining soils, by not disturbing them, and using our own human labor. So that means we can do it. It just means we have to have a lot of farmers doing small farms. So that's what self-organization is. It's saying we should go this route. You know, relocalize, re-regionalize our economies, get rid of all that embedded energy, reduce that entropic cost. I'll give one more example. Another one of my grad students, about probably 8 years ago, started a time bank over in Brattleboro. The last time I checked, I think they had 300 to 400 members. It's voluntary. If you want to become a member of the time bank, you just say, I'm going to become a member. And what you offer is a skill that you have that you're good at and you also enjoy doing. So, you know, let's say you like running a chainsaw. You say, you know, I'm good with a chainsaw, I'll offer that. Or maybe you're good mudding sheetrock and you enjoy it. I can't imagine enjoying that, but maybe you do, and you offer that. Or maybe you like painting, or maybe you're a lawyer who wants to give free, you know, legal advice. You offer your specialty, and then someone in the time bank can say, yeah, I need to have you do 3 hours of work for me. So you do the work, and then now you can choose people in the time bank that have a specialty you don't have to do 3 hours of work for you. In this way, community members are building capacity by helping each other without any exchange of money. They're creating these relationships where they're really integrating and helping each other. And not only that, there's an added benefit. In this incredibly politically divisive climate that we are today, if you've done work for somebody and someone's done work for you and you've benefited each other and you may have very different political views, you can't quite look at that person as being the enemy anymore. You can see them as maybe not agreeing with you, but being a functional member of a community that you're in. That's another example of a self-organizing system where people have specializations and integrate. I think that this is a very important lesson for us to learn. And as citizens, this becomes our work, because we're never going to see change coming from the top down in complex systems. Social change always wells up from the bottom. It's going to be citizens who are going to lead the effort to re-self-organize our communities so that we're tightly integrated together, each member supporting every other member, embracing diversity, helping each other out, and having much smaller local and regional economies that don't have all that embedded energy and all that entropic cost. So I will just stop there and thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom. So we do have time for questions from the audience. For those of you who are watching virtually, you can continue to submit your questions by using the live comments section on Facebook or YouTube. And we have here ushers collecting yellow cards. So while they're doing that, I'll start with a question that I have, which is about climate change. So climate-related environmental changes are occurring faster, at a faster rate, more frequently than ever before. How does this factor into your thinking on coevolution? Will the natural world be able to keep up in the face of climate change?
Well, the natural world's gone through at least 5 major extinction events in the past. The Permian extinction being the biggest one, where something like more than 90% of the species were extinguished. I don't think climate change is going to be that impactive compared to that. And life's a self-organizing system, so yes, it'll bounce back. The problem is that, you know, when we've had these major extinction events, it takes about 10 to 15 million years for the biotic diversity to get back up to where it was previously. But from the biosphere's perspective, that's not terribly long. So it's just a matter of perspective. So yes, the biosphere is going to be OK. It's going to be human systems that are going to have a real tough time.
OK, some questions from the audience. What was the role of early humans in their ecosystem? Does that give any clue to what we should be doing now, or are there just too many of us?
Well, there probably are too many of us, but I think, yes, you know, humans have been on this planet for 200,000 years, and for more than 95% of that time, human culture was one culture. It was basically gathering and hunting clan culture. And it didn't matter what part of the world you were in. People in those cultures saw themselves as a part of nature, not apart from it. And they worshiped the earth as their mother and saw all the other creatures in the earth as being brethren, because the earth was their mother too. So there's this incredible reverence and connection to Mother Earth. We have lost that in our culture, and that's really our major problem. We have a worldview that is misguided. That original worldview is really, really important. But the other thing is that in those clan groups, there was a very important focus on the well-being of the clan. Robin Wall Kimmerer calls the economy of a clan society like that as being a gift economy. Everything was given. So if someone was successful in a hunt, it was shared with all the members of the clan, knowing that if someone else was successful in the future, it would be shared back. They had giving away ceremonies, so no one acquired too many things and maintained an egalitarian atmosphere where everyone was equal and had equal say. Their view of the world was incredibly relational. Relational and connection to nature, relational and connection to members of their community. We've lost a lot of that in our society. A lot of our consumptive tendencies have sort of shredded that, and that's a real problem for us. I'll just add that on one bit. One of my former grad students in our Educating for Sustainability program taught Spanish at the Cambridge School. Before the earthquake in Haiti, she would take her classes down there. They'd go into these very poor villages and be greeted by these incredibly happy villagers that would try to give them whatever meager stuff they had. And they came away thinking, how could these very poor people be so happy? And what they realized, a lot of these kids came from very affluent neighborhoods. They didn't know their neighbors. They never saw their neighbors. And it began to sink in that what these poor people had was relationality. They had connection to their community, and that's what was keeping them going. So these are, again, very important lessons.
Okay, here's a big picture question. Is large-scale capitalism inherently incapable of healthy self-organization?
Yeah, because it's based on competition and not cooperation and developing networks of mutually beneficial relationships where everything's benefiting. So it's a whole different model. I think, you know, part of our worldview that got lost started with this idea that we are separate from nature. We have dominion over it. It gave ideas of ownership, dominance, competition, control. They're not the things that are going to help us out.
It's a lot of questions, so I'm trying to get to as many as we can. But so will Elon Musk's effort to colonize Mars be a solution to Earth's lack of self-organization, or the opposite?
Well, I think it's a real crazy idea to begin with, but it's not going to have any impact, except it's going to have entropic costs in the biosphere here, because every time you send a ship off this planet, you're using huge, huge amounts of energy and creating a lot of entropic costs. I'm reminded of one of our grad students who started the Mars Foundation. And they actually built a biosphere-type facility way up in the Arctic, training people how they could go to Mars. And one day, he was walking on a walk through the woods, And he got this epiphany. He said, why would anyone want to leave this and go to Mars? And he came to us to get some environmental background. He thought, I'm just on the completely wrong track here. And I'd say, yeah, why would anyone want to go to Mars and leave this behind? I just, you know, I think we're hardwired to need relationship community and to need relationship to the natural world. And why we would leave that behind seems absolutely insane to me.
Okay. Here's one. People can get overwhelmed with information and everything that's happening. Do you have advice for current simple action steps for people now?
Yeah, I'd say just find where you can plug in your communities. You know, volunteering, helping people. You know, you can start with baby steps. I remember I taught at the Putney School years ago. I just said, let's list on the board things we can do right here at the Putney School that can reduce our impact. And, you know, people put on things like turn off lights and leave the room, don't flush the toilet if it just has urine in it. And we just started adding. And I said, all right, choose one of these things that sort of resonates with you and practice it until it becomes a habit. And then come back and take another one. And what students found was they could take on more and more and more at their own pace, but it's just a matter of starting, and then once you've gotten something under your belt, you can take on more, and you take on more, and it snowballs. So I'd say you find your own personal niche. So that's your specialty. You plug in where you can and start working it in your communities and building out from there. Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't work at larger scales as well. We can, but I think we need to be working in our communities importantly right now.
Here's one, kind of going back to your example about the chestnut. How important is it to attempt to eradicate invasive plants?
Well, I think it's more like triage. We can't eradicate invasives. Once they're here, they're here. So I think that we got to be judicious where we put our efforts. I'd say if they're just starting to get a toehold in an area, we can easily weed them out. Doesn't take much effort. We make sure that areas that have rare and endangered species, we keep them out of there because we don't want them knocking out our native species and extinguishing them. If we have unique ecosystems, we work there. And then we can, you know, add in other areas we can work at if we have the capacity. But there's going to be lots of areas we can't work on, and that's the place that coevolution is going to work its magic. It takes time, but it will. Now, 3 million years ago, the Isthmus of Panama formed. And North and South America had been separated for tens of millions of years, and lots of South American species migrated into North America, lots of North American species went into South America. I can assure you it was way scarier back then in terms of invasive than it is today, and yet now all those species are natives to their region. They've worked it out, they've co-evolved. So we can't get rid of invasives. We need to be judicious about protecting our natives where we can, and trying to keep some of our intact ecosystems intact, but a lot of areas we let go, and that's where natural selection is going to work its magic.
There's a couple of questions kind of looking at this tension between the demand for redundancy and having repeating behaviors or roles in a system compared to that special demand for specialization. So people are wondering, you know, how common is one versus the other? How does a larger system kind of create that demand for repeating behaviors?
Right. So they're actually the same thing. The specialization is what gives rise to the redundancy. So you need to get the specialization to get the diversity, which creates the redundancy, which creates the resilience. So they're both the same thing. In our case, I think that's why I say it's the work of citizens. We have got to promote that. We have got to find ways to find our specialized niches, offer them into our communities, intentionally patronize local patrons, local businesses, small farms to support them. I know that in some towns, there are CSAs that have developed over in Vermont that involve 4 independent farms. You can have a produce grower, an organic meat grower, organic baker, and an organic dairy, all integrating their products into one CSA, and they find it increases their profitability. They remain independent, but what they're doing is they're integrating. So it's ways that we have to find avenues to do this, because it's not going to happen any other way. It's us that are going to be the change agent here.
And this is a related question. You've talked a little bit about this, but this is from one of the folks watching online. They want to know, what are the biggest changes you have personally made in your life to address this sustainability issue?
Well, I guess, you know, probably the single biggest change was realizing that my niche is as an educator. I've been asked to, you know, go into politics and other things, and basically, that's not for me. I would not do well in a political setting. That's not the type of person I am. I think it's important to find your niche and then pursue it, and I've done that. I've really applied my professional career in this way to being an educator, trying to get the word about this stuff to help mobilize people to do these things. So I'd say that's probably the personal biggest thing I've done.
Okay. You've talked a lot about self-organization. Someone in the audience is wondering, what role can or should the government play in this movement?
Well, I think that governments will follow citizens' movements. So I know that, like, when over in Vermont, where citizens really got activated about really supporting local farms, the government started actually putting in state policies to do the same thing. So, like I said, all large-scale social change bubbles from the bottom up. When the movement gets big enough, governments follow. So they're not going to initiate it unless there's enough of a populace really demanding it.
All right. And this is, a few people asked this question. How does this apply to commercial goods, things like computers or medical supplies or cars or clothing, things that really have become globalized in our economy that are harder to manufacture or create?
It's going to be hard. I mean, I'm not saying we get rid of all large corporations, and I'm not the one who could figure this out. But we're going to have to really move in the opposite direction, because if we don't, the entropic momentum will start to bring the system down. Like I said, it's not a question of if that'll happen. It's when that'll happen, unless we dramatically start changing things. And I don't have the expertise to say how we do that with computers or cars or whatever else. But we're going to have to change.
There's only time for one more. It's really hard to pick. So this is an interesting one. Many communes or communal living situations get started in order to be self-organized. This person's wondering, but why do so many fail? What's the...
Well, you know, I think that you often have a cloistered environment, and you can have power hierarchies that develop. I mean, I've never been in one, so I don't know for sure. So I'm not thinking that you have an artificially developed something like this. I think it happens in communities with individuals working it out on their own with other individuals. You don't start with a contrived idea that this is how it's going to be. It's more organic, I think.
Great. Thank you, Tom. If your question didn't get asked, there will be time for during refreshments to come and talk with Tom. So I want to again thank Tom for sharing your time and expertise with us.
Thank you very much.
And for those at home, we hope you've enjoyed today's live broadcast of the Monadnock Summer Lyceum. Thank you all for your support of the 2022 season. Please join us next week to hear Roseanne Leipzig talking on the topic, Honest Aging, What's the Right Medical Care for Older Adults? And those of you who are here in person, please join us for an informal reception in the parish hall through the door to my right. You'll have an opportunity to have some further conversation with Tom, to enjoy cold drinks, to buy some books. And we ask that you do please respect social distancing when approaching the bookseller and our speaker. Thank you.